Employees of the streaming giant walk out, protesting comedian Dave Chappelle's controversial new special as the company's CEO admits he made a mistake. And life support. Some hospitals in Africa take oxygen production into their own hands to save the lives of those most vulnerable.
Once we're able to provide reliable systems for pediatrics, for neonatal, that then frees up more oxygen for the adults, for COVID and other cases.
All that and more on tonight's PBS NewsHour.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by economy for 160 years. BNSF, the engine that connects us. Consumer Cellular. Johnson & Johnson. Financial services firm, Raymond James.
BDO, accountants and advisors.
Supporting social entrepreneurs and their solutions to the world's most pressing problems. SkollFoundation.org.
The Lemelson Foundation, committed to improving lives through invention in the U.S. and developing countries. On the web at Lemelson.org. Supported by the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, committed to building a more just, verdant, and peaceful world. More information at macfound.org. And with the ongoing support of these institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
I'm Stephanie Tsai with NewsHour West. We'll return to the full program after the latest headlines. Major new developments tonight on COVID-19 vaccinations. The FDA has approved mixing and matching booster doses of the Moderna, Johnson & Johnson, and Pfizer vaccines. The CDC still has to give its approval. Meanwhile, the White House rolled out plans to vaccinate 28 million young children nationwide with low-dose shots of Pfizer's vaccine.
We have secured vaccine supply to vaccinate every child ages 5 through 11. And as soon as the vaccine is authorized by the FDA, we will begin shipping millions of doses nationwide. These vaccine doses will be shipped with all the supplies needed to vaccinate kids, including smaller needles.
We'll return to vaccinating American children after the news summary. Also today, New York City ordered 46,000 police, firefighters, and other city employees to get vaccinated by November 1st or be placed on unpaid leave. And in California, the popular hamburger chain In-N-Out is doubling down on its stance against rules that require diners to show vaccination cards. San Francisco's and another Bay Area county's health departments have taken punitive actions against the chain, including closing one restaurant. The company said it refuses to become, quote, the vaccination police for any government. Russia's President Vladimir Putin has ordered most workers to take off from their jobs for at least a week as COVID cases and deaths keep rising. More than 1,000 Russians died in the previous 24 hours, the most yet. Only about a third of the country's adult population is fully vaccinated. Nicholas Cruz pleaded guilty to murdering 17 people at a high school in Parkland, Florida in 2018. It was one of the nation's deadliest school shootings. Families of the victims were at the hearing. Some shook their heads and others were moved to tears. Cruz then offered a brief apology.
I am very sorry for what I did, and I have to live with it every day. And that if I were to get a second chance, I would do everything in my power to try to help others. And I am doing this for you, and I do not care if you do not believe me.
The court will begin selecting a jury in January to decide if Cruz gets life in prison or a death sentence. President Biden was out today pitching a scaled-back economic package. As of last night, it totaled roughly $2 trillion in social and climate spending. That's down from $3.5 trillion. The president visited Scranton, Pennsylvania today and told reporters, quote, "I think we'll get a deal." Senate Democrats tried and failed again today to advance a voting rights bill. They needed 60 votes to limit debate, but all 50 Republicans voted no. Democrats wanted to counter new voting restrictions in GOP-controlled states. Republicans said that's federal overreach. Party leaders spoke before the vote.
It's ludicrous for any Republican to assert that the federal government has no role to play in safeguarding elections when state laws disenfranchise American citizens.
For multiple years running, Washington Democrats have offered a rotating merry-go-round of rationales to explain why they need to federalize voting laws and take over all of American elections themselves.
We'll talk with a Democratic senator later in the program. President Biden's nominee for ambassador to Japan, Rahm Emanuel, today defended his actions as mayor of Chicago in the handling of a black teenager's death. Laquan McDonald was killed by a white police officer 7 years ago today. Emanuel told his Senate confirmation hearing that he did nothing wrong, but that the tragedy has stayed with him.
I said then, I'm the mayor, and I'm responsible and accountable for fixing this so this never happens again. And to be honest, there's not a day or a week that has gone by in the last 7 years I haven't thought about this and thought about the what ifs and the changes and what could have been.
Emanuel said legal rules barred release of the police video of McDonald's killing for more than a year. The NFL has proposed changes to its $1 billion concussion settlement. The league faced outcry over how it decided dementia claims by using race-based adjustments in cognitive test scores. So-called race norming made it harder for retired black players to win the lucrative claims. The league agreed to halt the practice back in June. About 70% of active players and 60% of living retirees are black. A new climate study concludes that worldwide production of fossil fuels will have to be cut by more than half to avert dangerous levels of global warming. The United Nations report also says many governments plan to double coal, oil, and natural gas output through 2030. The findings come days before a UN climate summit convenes. Still to come on the NewsHour, ballot battle. Senate Republicans block Democrats' latest attempt to vote on sweeping federal voting legislation. Pandemic in Syria. The country's last rebel stronghold sees a surge in Delta cases without vaccines or available hospital beds. Dreaming big, why a tuba and the surprising way he plays it gives one musician a sense of belonging and much more.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
As we reported, the White House laid out plans today so that children between the ages of 5 and 11 could soon receive the COVID-19 vaccine. But as William Brangham reports, many are still wondering about when or whether to get their children vaccinated.
Judy, the White House is hoping for this authorization from the FDA and the CDC for Pfizer's vaccine within a few weeks. That's after federal regulators examine the safety and efficacy of a low-dose vaccine for kids. Once approved, shots could begin as soon as November. Yet some parents question if the vaccine is necessary for their kids and if there are other options available. Here to answer some of those questions is Dr. Jennifer Nuzzo. She's lead epidemiologist for the Johns Hopkins COVID-19 Testing Insights Initiative. Dr. Nuzzo, great to have you back on the NewsHour. The Biden administration seems very optimistic that they're going to get this authorization, but between here and there, there's still a lot of scrutiny over these vaccines for kids. What kind of things are the FDA and CDC looking at?
Sure, and I think it's important to stress that there still is a regulatory process that has to happen, and there are going to be independent panels of experts, both convened by the CDC and the FDA, to review the data. They're going to be looking at how children fared after receiving the vaccine from a safety perspective, and they're actually going to be looking at certain levels of protection in the children's immune systems suggest that they're maybe protected if they're exposed to the virus. We don't have the same kind of monitoring for severe illness in children like we did for adults, because children are less likely to experience severe illness, but they'll look for some level of that the vaccines offer protection.
And you do hear that, the point that you're just making. Some parents and adults say, you know, it looks like kids don't really get that sick, so why do I even need to consider vaccinating them?
Sure, and the truth is the kind of risk-benefit calculation for children is different than adults, and it needs to be different than adults, and that's why it has to have a separate process to scrutinize the data separately from adults. It has been a blessing in this pandemic that our children have been largely spared the worst effects of COVID-19, but not all children have been, sadly. And so I know many parents, while the statistics of how many children wind up having severe illness may be low, that's not really comforting to parents, not knowing if your child is going to be the exception rather than the norm. So I think the vaccines are offering some hope to parents who are worried about that, but also they offer other benefits besides just preventing severe illness. I'm a mom of two young kids who are not yet able to be vaccinated, and I'm looking forward to these vaccines to hopefully return some of the normalcy to their lives and to reduce our worries about the likelihood of transmitting to others, to potentially enable us to, you know, travel more easily and without worries. So I think the benefits to kids are different than adults, and they have to be considered differently.
What do we know about side effects, and what should parents think about with regards to side effects?
So that's what's going to be evaluated by the committees. There's going to be first the consideration of the temporary side effects, the things that we tend to feel when you get vaccinated. Likely they're going to be mild, just like we heard about the adult vaccines, you know, arm soreness, you know, mild sort of flu-like symptoms for a very short period of time. They're going to evaluate the frequency of that and how severe those side effects were. But then they're also going to consider what the other slightly longer side effects. Now, I have to stress that the other things that we'd be looking for, the things that we heard about as surfacing as an issue with the vaccination of young adults, things like heart inflammation, those are reported, you know, within not just a day or two, but perhaps a week or so after vaccination. They're going to be looking to understand that. I don't think the trials are necessarily large enough to detect that, but they're going to assess, you know, what the likelihood of that occurring is, both given the fact that children are going to receive a different dose and the fact that they have different risk benefit calculations. But I want to stress, because I think there's this misconception out there that somehow we expect that, you know, months from now or perhaps years from now after vaccinating, that side effects will manifest. And that's just not something that we expect to happen with vaccines. That's not really how vaccines work. So I just want to put parents at ease who may be worried that if I choose to vaccinate my child, will years down the road something manifest? That's really not something that I see as being likely, and in my view, not something to particularly worry about.
So let's say the approval does come and kids start getting vaccinated. The question then becomes, do schools around the country start mandating this vaccine like they do MMR, diphtheria, hepatitis B, et cetera? Do you think that will happen? Should that happen?
So we're already seeing some places have conversations about it, and certainly that's been an active conversation in California. Los Angeles County, I believe, voted to mandate vaccines in their district. In my view, it's a premature to be talking about mandates. Let's look at the data. Let's look at these vaccines. Let's understand how they work. And crucially, let's talk to parents. We have so much more work to do to overcome parents' concerns about these vaccines. One of the worries that I've had is that we haven't really seen the level of uptake among teens who are already eligible to be vaccinated that we could see. And so you can imagine that the same concerns may exist for vaccinating either younger children. So I think we have a lot more work to do to address that residual hesitancy that may be there. And in my view, conversations about mandates are really premature and possibly make those conversations even harder.
Separately, I just want to ask one question about this, the news of the day today, that the FDA seems that they're going to authorize the ability to so-called mix and match, meaning if you got Pfizer, you could get a booster of Moderna or vice versa. What is the benefit of that? Why would anyone want to consider mixing and matching their vaccines?
Well, one benefit may just be convenience and just, you know, where you can go and what they have to offer you. But, you know, I think there may be some additional benefits in terms of, you know, enhanced protection from being exposed to a slightly different vaccine and challenging your immune system in different ways. I think this is probably a bigger issue for people who have received Johnson & Johnson and whether they would benefit from having a different second dose than their first dose.
Dr. Jennifer Nuzzo of Johns Hopkins, always great to have you. Thank you very much for being here.
Thanks for having me.
As we reported earlier, the partisan divide in Washington was on full display today as a Democrat-backed voting bill failed to move forward in the U.S. Senate. Every Republican lined up in opposition to the so-called Freedom to Vote Act that Democrats say would have improved voting access and election integrity. Senator Tim Kaine of Virginia co-sponsored the legislation, and he joins me now. Senator, very good to have you back on the NewsHour.
Thanks, Judy.
What does it mean that Republicans were able to block this measure even from coming up for a vote?
Well, Judy, as you point out, this was a vote to debate the bill, not to pass it, to debate it. And we made a very unusual offer to Republicans in the Senate, which is if you vote to let us debate this bill, we will give you unlimited amendments. You can offer as many amendments as you want, and then you could still vote against it at the end if you didn't like it. But every Republican lined up to basically block debate on the bill. 50 Democrats support this bill. I worked very, very hard with 7 colleagues to put it together. It would protect people's access to the ballot. It would eliminate dark money by requiring campaign contributions to be fully disclosed. It would end partisan gerrymandering on congressional seats. And it would also protect election officials so that their duties couldn't be stripped away from them by state legislatures or others if they don't like how they're going to call an election. This is really important, and it doesn't end here. Democrats are just absolutely, with a sense of urgency, riveted upon the need to get this done. And so we're now going to have to assess how we can, in this Senate, restore the Senate to a place that will protect voting rights, which has been the case in the past and needs to be the case now.
Well, Senator, what does that mean? I mean, what are the options? Is this the moment now to go to the mat, for Democrats to go to the mat on the matter of the filibuster? And that means your fellow Democrat, Senator Joe Manchin.
I would be perfectly comfortable if there was no filibuster in the Senate. I reached that conclusion shortly after I got here. As you know, I was a governor, and I was working with the state legislature where we did things by majority rule. There was no supermajority vote requirement in the Virginia State Senate. In fact, most legislative bodies work like that, and it's fine. So I would have the Senate operate like most state legislatures operate. But I do have at least 2 colleagues on the Senate side, the Democratic side, who do not want to abolish the filibuster. But the good news, Judy, is we don't have to. We can write the Senate rules, and the filibuster and other Senate rules have been reformed over time. And as far as I know, no Democrats have taken off the table an openness to discussing how can we create reforms that would restore the Senate, restore it to a place where you can get action on something as important as voting rights, and the majority is not stopped from moving forward on such an important priority. We'll start to have those discussions. Leader Schumer is very passionate about this, wants us to try to get this done by Thanksgiving, and I share that sense of urgency.
But in the meantime, Senator Kaine, you have progressives in your party, in particular, many black Americans, black voters who supported President Joe Biden, who are now saying we supported him because we thought he was going to do something about voting rights, and it hasn't happened. What do you say to those Americans today who are looking at this?
Judy, they're right. We owe them a result. At the end of the day, we told them, if you give us a majority, we're going to govern like we have a majority. And we have the White House and both houses. And this is not just like any other priority. Of course, there's a lot of things we like to do. This is of existential importance. I stress this all the time. The 100 senators who are here now are the only 100 in the history of this country who were here when there was a domestic insurrection that attacked the Capitol to overturn an election. The attack of January 6, 2021 was an effort to disenfranchise the 80 million people who had voted for Joe Biden and Kamala Harris. And it was an effort to disenfranchise people based on this big lie of, oh, it was rigged, it was stolen, there's voter fraud. All those things that President Trump said were false. But that same big lie is being repeated ad nauseum in states with Republican legislatures and Republican governors, and they're taking away people's rights to vote. So to all the activists out there, just keep being active and keep demanding that we get a result. We have to get a result. We have to protect people's rights to vote, and I'm not going to rest until we do, and I know Leader Schumer is in the same position.
And of course, Senator, even if this legislation had passed, which it didn't even come close to doing, there still would not have been a mechanism to do something about Republican-controlled state legislatures that are starting across the country to take over local voting systems, as they have done in the state of Georgia. What's to stop Republican-controlled legislatures in state after state from doing the same thing?
Well, this bill actually does contain guards against that, Judy, the kind of fourth pillar of the bill, which wasn't originally in the first version, the For the People Act, because we hadn't seen state legislatures doing this at the time. But this bill, the Freedom to Vote Act, would put some significant limitations on states taking the power away from election officials. And would give the Justice Department some significant tools to deal with that kind of scheme.
But right this now, that's not in law.
Not until we pass this bill. You're right. If we pass this bill, we can protect access to ballot, protect the integrity of elections, get rid of dark money, secret money, by requiring disclosure, and also end partisan gerrymandering in congressional seats. These are items that are overwhelmingly popular, and not just with Democrats. Republican voters like these ideas. Independent voters like these ideas. And we have a Democratic majority, and our folks expect us to get this done, and we're going to get this done.
Senator Tim Kaine, who was a co-sponsor of the voting rights legislation. Thank you, Senator.
Absolutely.
A new national poll paints a troubling picture of an American electorate worried about the future of democracy, sharply divided on issues of personal freedom and dissatisfied with President Biden's leadership. Here to walk us through the results is Ann Selzer. She is the president of Selzer & Company, which wrote the poll in collaboration with Grinnell College. Ann Selzer, welcome back to the NewsHour. It's very good to see you. A number of striking things here to ask you about, starting with this question about people's trust in our democracy. You have, in what we find in these results, is a majority of Americans saying that they believe democracy is facing a major threat. And we see that number driven by Republicans. 71% of them think that's true, compared to 35% of Democrats. What do you see is driving this?
Well, the reason we wanted to go after this was a focus by Grinnell College on looking at the health of American democracy. So we went at it from sideways issues, but this is hitting it head on. Do you perceive that American democracy is under major threat, minor threat, or really no threat at all? And there have been sobering conversations on both sides of the aisle about what the threat currently is. And I think the findings of this poll reveals that at the heart, the bigger perceived threat is Republicans listening to the talk about the election being stolen, about the electoral system being broken, and that has really set in a way that makes them believe the democracy is a major threat. Democrats are not nearly as roiled up about a sense of doom for the democracy.
Fascinating. And as you say, we've seen a lot of conversation, a lot of editorials written about the threats to democracy on the Democratic side. So interesting to see these results. Ann Selzer, you asked about President Biden. We see in what you found, he's facing some of his lowest approval ratings yet. He's 37% approval, 50% disapproving. Which voters, what issues do you see behind this?
Right. Well, in terms of issues, we asked for approval ratings and how he's doing with immigration, where he scored very poorly, just 27% approving. We also took a look at how he's doing with COVID. And sadly, this is, you might say, is the high watermark for him. He still doesn't get 50% approval on how he's doing with COVID, and that's his benchmark issue. He also only gets 36% approval with the economy. And as the economy goes, so goes the president's standing. So it's no surprise that that number at 36 is almost exactly what his overall numbers are for approval. Two groups I would call out. One is that he gets more disapproval by a lot with independents than approval. So it's almost a 2-to-1 ratio, twice as many disapproving as approving, and independents were crucial to his electoral success. He is also underwater, not by as much, but with women. And women throughout the campaign were of his strongest supporters. He does better with suburban women, but not exactly a lot to be proud of. It's 46% to 38% more approving than disapproving, but he's not even halfway with suburban women. So, and they were a bulwark of his campaign.
And they certainly were. It's so interesting to see that. You also asked about trust in I guess you could say, community leaders. You asked people to weigh in on how much they trust, have confidence in people like doctors, police officers, teachers, other civil servants. And you saw a lot of political divide here.
And that was so fascinating and maybe confirmed what we might have already suspected, but in big, big numbers. So the one group that was tested that uniformly, regardless of your party identification, tested very well were nurses. 68% saying they have high trust, very little difference by party. Among Democrats, also about that high, doctors and scientists, over 60% saying they have high trust. But among Republicans, it's just 28% who say they have high trust in scientists. And again, once you see these numbers, it sort of unpacks the things that people have been talking about and saying all along, that the approach for the Democrats was to put a lot of stake in the ability of doctors and scientists to communicate about COVID. What these data are saying is the Republicans are not buying it.
And we saw, I think, on that same question, very low levels of confidence in federal employees. One other thing I do want to ask you about is the Supreme Court. You asked respondents about what they think drives the decisions that the justices make. 62% bipartisan think the court's decisions are driven by politics and would support 15-year terms. Term limits for members of the court. Really interesting.
Well, and especially interesting, Judy, given the makeup of the court, was that there was very little difference whether you were a Republican, a Democrat, or independent. That 62% number of saying that they felt decisions were based on the political views of the justices rather than the Constitution and law, that came across very evenly, as did the idea of perhaps making a change of how justices are appointed. To have a fixed term, maybe it's 15 years, there was equal support for that, 62%. Again, very little partisan difference.
That is a number, that assumption that the court driven by politics, that is a number that we are clearly seeing rise. Ann Selzer, again, so many interesting pieces of this poll to look at. Thank you very much for joining us. We appreciate it.
My pleasure.
It was an especially violent day today in Syria. Damascus saw its deadliest bombing in 4 years, when more than a dozen government soldiers were killed in a bus attack. And in northwest Idlib, shelling killed 10, including 4 children. Idlib is the final stronghold for rebels who are fighting the Assad regime. Today, it is facing its most severe wave of COVID. A warning now, the images in this story can be difficult to watch. As Nick Schifrin reports, COVID is hitting hospitals already weakened by war.
In Idlib's newest COVID ward, the patients are too young to understand why they cry. Iman is 3 and suffering from malnutrition and now COVID. Others are even more vulnerable. The youngest patient in this children's hospital, also named Iman, is 15 days old. It is heartbreaking work for doctors who have to go home and care for their own children.
Children are dying. The Delta variant in particular is very strong and hitting children particularly badly.
Dr. Sobi Sam is a pediatrician. He struggles to give life to those who are supposed to have so long to live.
We ask our fellow residents of northern Syria, take the vaccine as a social responsibility, because this is the reality we are living in right now.
Ali al-Hassan's reality is in his garden, thinking of his 63-year-old father, Ibrahim. When Ibrahim got sick, Ali had to visit 7 healthcare centers to find an open bed. On this day, Ali's 5 children, among Ibrahim's 13 grandchildren, helped their father tend the family garden. Their destination, Ibrahim's grave. He died of COVID 3 weeks ago.
He died about a week after we found a spot in the hospital for him. It was very difficult and tiring for all of us.
Ali and his kids plant seeds that Ibrahim will never get to see in this area that has already seen so much death. Last month, confirmed cases in Idlib almost doubled, largely due to the Delta variant. Doctors rushed to restart this man's heart. This time, he lives. Idlib's hospitals are beyond capacity. There are less than 130 ICU beds for the province's 4 million residents. Dr. Absi Al-Fouad is a doctor in Idlib's largest hospital for COVID-19 patients.
It's taking a massive physical and mental toll on our healthcare workers. The PPE and oxygen supply we have now is not nearly enough to handle the influx of cases coming into this hospital.
Despite that influx, Russia and the Syrian regime continue to attack. The UN says in the last 2 years, they've targeted more than 80 medical facilities. The need is most acute in Idlib's refugee camps. Miles away from the Turkish border, 1.5 million people call this home. At these camps, residents who are younger than the war are dependent on aid workers for water and oxygen. Canisters are delivered into tents by the NGO Rahma, Arabic for mercy. Noor Karmash is the coordinator.
The whole situation is deteriorating and getting from bad to worse.
But these canisters can't meet the need. There's a massive oxygen shortage. One tank can cost as much as $130.
We as NGOs, we're trying our best to deliver the aid to the need, but the need is greater than the help we're getting from the communities, from the countries, and from the WHO.
The WHO, or World Health Organization, is providing some AstraZeneca and Chinese Sinovac vaccines. But less than 1% of Idlib's residents are fully vaccinated because of a lack of supply and some hesitancy. But for many, COVID is only one of their worries. The UN says 97% live in extreme poverty. COVID exacerbated struggles of even those relatively well off. 28-year-old teacher Radwan Amin got sick in April.
I had to work from home even though I'm very sick on typing Word documents for university students. This work doesn't provide very much, but it helped me survive.
Others have no choice but to get their hands dirty. And car mechanics in Idlib's industrial zone, like Abu Mahmoud Hamoui, can't afford masks.
The health offices keep bothering us about masks. But I work here and have grease and oil on my hands all day. I would need 10 masks a day. 10 masks, 5 liras per mask. That's 50 liras. That feeds a whole family.
Families continue to struggle. But after years of distance, regional governments are gradually re-engaging with Syrian President Bashar al-Assad. Despite a Human Rights Watch report released today saying Syrian refugees returning to the country face grave human rights abuses and persecution in a country decimated by conflict and widespread destruction. But now, the volunteers known as White Helmets, who used to spend their days trying to save victims of bombings, are more often handling the victims of COVID. And their ambulances that once went to hospitals now go straight to cemeteries. For years, Idlib residents have witnessed far too much death. Now they are stalked by COVID. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Nick Schifrin.
The blowback to Dave Chappelle's latest comedy special, produced by Netflix, has reached a boiling point. Today, several dozen of Netflix's thousands of employees walked off the job, demanding the company better support its transgender workers. Amna Nawaz has the story.
Judy, this all goes back to The Closer, Dave Chappelle's highly watched special. But employees at Netflix, including some who walked off the job today, criticized that special, arguing it's offensive and could lead to harm of transgender people. In it, Chappelle compares trans identity to blackface and jokes about killing a woman. Now, Netflix's co-CEO, Ted Sarandos, initially doubled down on his support for Chappelle and the special. Yesterday, he said the special will remain online, but apologized, saying, quote, "I screwed up," and, quote, "I should have made sure to recognize that a group of our employees was hurting." Joining me now is Amara Jones. She's the creator of Translash Media. That's a media nonprofit that focuses on the transgender community. She also co-chaired the first ever UN high-level meeting on gender diversity. Amara, welcome to the NewsHour. Thanks for making the time. I have to point out, even after that acknowledgement from Sarando saying he screwed up, they're standing by the decision to stream the special. They're saying that it fits into their stance of what they call free artistic expression. And sometimes they say there's just content people won't like. What do you make of the way that they're responding to this at Netflix?
Well, I think that it shows that Netflix signs off on this content from the very highest levels. And we know from reporting from Bloomberg that actually Ted Sarandos signed off on this personally, which is a huge warning sign. Usually in media companies, when content decisions have to go to the highest levels, it means that no one else wanted to have their fingerprints on it. And what's strange about that is that people want to embrace success within companies. And so I think that what we're seeing, from the firing of employees to the personal statements that he made not once but twice last week, to the other actions that Netflix is taking, that Ted Sarandos, at the highest level of that company, believes in this content, believes in the views expressed by it, and, as he said last week, doesn't see that there's any real-world harm.
Well, explain to me that real-world harm, because I think this is what people may question, is if they don't understand the backlash, help us understand. What's your concern? What's at stake here?
Well, I think the first thing to realize is that this is essentially hate speech disguised as jokes. And that is an essential point here, that no one is contesting that humor can be outrageous, sometimes offensive, but I think that this crosses the line into hate speech that's disguised as jokes. And one of the ways in which it puts people at harm is that it essentially argues that trans people aren't real. It essentially argues that Black trans people aren't real. And at the heart of the violence against trans people, specifically Black trans people, where we have broken records of murders of Black trans women for several years in a row now, at the heart of those murders, when you look into them, is the belief by the perpetrators that they weren't doing anything wrong. That is to say that the person isn't human. And here we have that reinforced on a massive scale, the questioning of the fundamental humanity of trans people disguised as jokes, which is at the heart of the violence against our community.
Just to underscore that point, Amara, the data does speak volumes here. According to Human Rights Campaign, 2021 is set to be the most violent year on record for transgender and gender nonconforming people. I also want to put to you, though, this other point that the CEO makes, that this is on brand for Dave Chappelle and for his brand of comedy, that comedy is supposed to be provocative. And a lot of his defenders say, look, there are a lot of offensive jokes in here. He jokes about Chinese people. He jokes about Jewish people. He has long made derogatory comments about women. They just say comedy's supposed to be provocative. Shouldn't there be a space for that? What do you say to that?
Well, it's also supposed to be intelligent. And there's nothing intelligent about mocking trans people. There's nothing interesting or provocative about mocking trans people. There's nothing interesting in joking about rape. And it's really hard to see how any of that stands. And what may be different is that in the past, there would be a sprinkling of those types of jokes in his comedy in the midst of other things that were perhaps insightful, all the rest of it. I think that what fascinates me about this special is that if you were to take out all of the anti-LGBTQIA material, there would not be much of a special left. That's pretty much what the entire special is. And he has decided to go out in this final special, he says, not on a high of anything intelligent, but in terms of settling scores with the community that he doesn't like.
We should point out, along with today's walkout at Netflix, the trans employees there have submitted a list of demands to the company: more investment in trans talent, a revision of all the internal processes that decide which content gets made and how it goes out there. Amara, what should we expect to see from Netflix next?
I think that what we should expect to see is more of the same. I think that when you have the commitment from now the most powerful man in Hollywood, from the most powerful streaming service in the world that says it will make commitments to put out $6 billion worth of content next year, when he's behind this type of material, I don't know that we'll see much change from Netflix, although I hope that I'm proved wrong. I think what we should see is what the employees are demanding. What they are demanding is a radically different platform that will allow trans creators the opportunities to be able to be heard.
I hear you saying you would like to see change, but you're not optimistic it will happen. Is that right?
I'm not optimistic in the short term. I do think, Amna, that there are a couple of things that will eat away at Netflix that will drive change. I think first of those, really quickly, is the fact that there are lots of people who are saying that they don't wish to work with Netflix right now. I've had producers and showrunners tell me that. They are having people be fired and resigned. And the third thing is that Netflix may become a stigma brand. That is to say, it may no longer be a place where you're proud to say that you work. And if that's the case, they will lose employees to their competitors who are dying to know Netflix's secrets. And if those employers allow those new employees to not only bring their knowledge, but also this desire for more diverse content, over time, Netflix could be in real trouble.
We'll be watching and following for sure. That is Amara Jones, the creator of Translash Media, joining us tonight. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you so much.
The pandemic is bringing new attention to a critical healthcare challenge plaguing many countries, a shortage or unreliable supply of medical oxygen. It's also prompting many medical providers to look at ways to fix the problem. Special correspondent Fred DeSam-Lazaro reports on one example in Uganda. It's part of our series, Breakthroughs.
Do you ever run out of space here? It looks pretty busy.
Yes, there are very many.
Bed space is almost always in short supply in public hospitals like this one in Uganda's second largest city, Mbarara. But a bigger, ever-present concern for veteran head nurse Adiodata Aherwe is having a steady supply of oxygen to save this premature infant and so many others.
The lives of hundreds of patients every day in this Mbarara hospital depend on an uninterrupted supply of oxygen. In turn, the hospital's oxygen plant depends on an uninterrupted supply of electricity. And in Uganda, as in so many other countries, that is hardly guaranteed.
UNICEF says this scarcity or irregular supply of oxygen contributes to hundreds of thousands of child deaths every year. Along with drugs like antibiotics, oxygen therapy is critical in treating pneumonia at 800,000 victims each year, the biggest killer of children under five. Pneumonia is often found in severe malaria cases, like that of 9-year-old Frida, who was brought here by her dad, Bosanio Bazamanza.
She was breathing really badly when we came. They put her on oxygen, and now I'm seeing her breathing improving and getting better.
Frida is also one of the first few patients who've been put on a fail-safe oxygen delivery system that's being piloted in this hospital, called Oxylink.
So basically, this is a very simple system that ensures that we have an uninterrupted supply of oxygen.
Sheila Baganaya is a biomedical engineer and the Uganda head of 302, an Australian nonprofit that invented this system.
So we have a concentrator which makes oxygen from air.
So this is the oxygen concentrator.
This is a concentrator.
That oxygen is pumped into the lower of two 50-gallon bladders or flexible bags. On a shelf about 6 feet above it, the other bag is filled with water.
When there is a power cut, oxygen will then come from the bag to the patient.
In a power failure, she says, a sensor triggers the system to send water flowing by gravity from the upper bag to the lower.
The weight of the water will flow down and push this oxygen to the patient.
Because the water is heavier than the oxygen, so it's going to come down into this bag
and push
the oxygen
to the patient,
through the tubes to the patient.
Exactly.
And in the event of a long power outage, more than 2 hours perhaps, that would deplete the stored oxygen, she says a backup cylinder is on standby.
Normally we have short but frequent power cuts.
Yeah, but even a short power cut can mean the difference between life and death.
Exactly.
So far, it's proven 100% reliable, she says, serving 4 pediatric patients at a time. Free02, which is funded by several international charities, plans to scale up here and in 22 other rural East African hospitals. The focus will remain on pediatrics, but Baganaya says that benefits all patients.
Usually pediatric wards, neonatal wards, are some of the highest consumers of oxygen in a facility. So we find that once we are able to provide reliable systems for like pediatrics, for neonatal, that then frees up more oxygen for the adults, for COVID and other cases.
Nusa Haraway, who's worked here for more than 2 decades, is encouraged by all the attention now being paid to the oxygen supply, attention that's heightened by the pandemic. The improving supply is helping save many more lives than was possible just a few years ago, she says.
How many patients would you lose?
20% of children because of oxygen. But these days, we're in 5%, 6%. They don't die because of oxygen, they die because of underlying conditions. But for oxygen, at least these days, we are fine.
Allowing her, like so many more patients, to breathe more easily. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Fred DeSam-Lazaro in Imbarara, Uganda.
Fred's reporting is in partnership with the Undertold Stories Project at the University of St. Thomas in Minnesota. And now, one man's unlikely journey from the streets of Baltimore to concert halls around the globe, thanks to his mastery of the tuba. Jeffrey Brown has this story for our arts and culture series, Canvas.
Sound goes in.
It's not every day you get a tuba demonstration.
I take a deep breath. And sometimes I like to have fun, which means I like to do multiphonics, which is singing in the tuba.
Especially one like this.
And then I like to add a little beatbox to it. And you put it all together.
Now, is that in the classical repertoire?
Not yet, but we're working on it.
Richard Antoine White is a classical musician. He's principal tubist for the Santa Fe Symphony and the New Mexico Philharmonic. And if he hasn't yet brought beatboxing to the tradition, he has brought an inspiring personal story.
If you look at my entire life, it was a long shot for me to be successful. Against all odds, I am possible. Taking the word impossible and turning it into I am possible.
And that's what he's titled his new memoir, I'm Possible, a story of survival, a tuba, and the small miracle of a big dream. The 6'5" died at age 36. In his book, White calls her a hero.
Because I think she did one of the hardest things there is to do, is for a mother to give up their child and to be selfless, to have that child have a chance at life. And on her deathbed, her last dying words to my brother was, "I want you to be like your brother," which I can get a little emotional now, because to me, it signifies that she really loved me. And that's really real.
Music became his way forward. In middle school band, he latched onto the tuba, which he calls the underdog instrument.
It represents me. The tuba is big, it's bulky, clumsy sometimes, but yet it can be powerful, beautiful, and dominant. I always say my job in the orchestra is to show everyone else how bad they suck at rhythm and pitch.
He attended high school at the highly selective Baltimore School for the Arts, college at the Peabody Institute, the oldest conservatory in the country, and Indiana University's prestigious Jacobs School of Music, where he became the first ever African American to earn a doctorate in tuba performance.
And one, and two, and one, and two, and one, and two, and one. Stop! Absolutely amazing!
Now 48, he teaches at the University of New Mexico, one of just two black tenured tuba professors in the country.
Da 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 da.
He's made it on his own terms.
On the classical stage, you can't help but be aware that you're the only one that looks like you on stage.
Mm-hmm. Which is probably the case for you a lot, right?
Yes, you're the only tuba player, because there's only one tuba for orchestra, and on top of it, you're the only African-American. And if you look out in the audience, you're lucky if you see one African-American in the audience. So you are conscious of that. What's fascinating to me is that we all have to choose from the same notes, whether you're Caucasian, African American. Hey, when I'm out the stage with my colleagues, they're not a set of notes that says for black people. And we work together towards a common goal. Mm-hmm. And I think finding a musical instrument was the first time I experienced a real sense of belonging.
He shares that now with students, tutoring a high school junior and helping him toward a full college scholarship.
Yes! You see what I'm saying? We're speaking the language, man! Yes!
Steering a graduate student to improvise New Orleans style. Contributing to a music scholarship he helped establish at Indiana for underrepresented students, even though he still carries his own student loans. And prepping recent alums for orchestral auditions. It's all part of paying back those who helped him succeed. He lives with his partner Yvonne and her adult children just outside Albuquerque, where he's helped build the 10-year-old New Mexico Philharmonic.
I've never been in a place with so much potential that hasn't quite achieved it yet. I want to be a part of the potential. I could have auditioned for other orchestras, but I think there's a sense of building something, growing something and saying, man, I was here from the beginning.
During the pandemic, White has performed in virtual concerts, like this one at Santa Fe's Meow Wolf. Later this year, he'll be back on stage in person with the Oakland and Santa Fe Symphonies. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Jeffrey Brown.
What a great story. And admit it, we've all always wanted to learn how to play the tuba. And on the NewsHour online, thousands of indigenous residents who are living on the coastline of Louisiana face a prolonged recovery after Hurricane Ida. But their efforts could be even more complicated because some belong to tribes not recognized by the U.S. government as eligible for federal assistance. We explore all this on our website, pbs.org/newshour. And that's the NewsHour for tonight. I'm Judy Woodruff. Join us online and again here tomorrow evening. For all of us at the PBS NewsHour, thank you. Please stay safe, and we'll see you soon.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by...
The rules of business are being reinvented with a more flexible workforce, by embracing innovation, by looking not only at current opportunities, but ahead to future ones.
People who know BDO.
For 25 years, Consumer Cellular's goal has been to provide wireless service that helps people communicate and connect. We offer a variety of no-contract plans, and our U.S.-based customer service team can help find one that fits you. To learn more, visit consumercellular.tv.
Johnson & Johnson. BNSF Railway. Financial services firm, Raymond James. The Ford Foundation, working with visionaries on the front lines of social change worldwide. And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you. This is PBS News Hour West. From WETA Studios in Washington and from our bureau at the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
You're watching PBS.